In this video, I'm going to prove to you that when you have a scalar-valued function of n variables, which is differentiable, then the directional derivative of that function f at a point a in the direction of a unit vector u can be computed as a dot product. It's the dot product of the gradient of f at a dotted with the unit vector u. So this is how we often compute directional derivatives to avoid having to use the limit definition of the directional derivative. We need f to be differentiable, though, in order to be able to do this. So first, let me write down what we know when we know that our function is differentiable. So in particular, since f is differentiable at a, then the following limit exists and equals zero. We can say the limit as x approaches a in Rn of the distance between the function f evaluated at x near a and the linearization of our function at a. So let me write down what I'm trying to say here. The linearization would be f at a plus the gradient of f at a dotted with x minus a. This distance divided by the distance between x and a exists and goes to zero. Okay, I'm going to say this again. When a function is differentiable at a point a in its domain, then when x approaches a, we can say that the distance between the function's actual value at x and the first order approximation, so this would be like the tangent line or tangent plane approximation to our function centered at a, this distance is small, so small that when we divide it by the distance between x and a, which is definitely going to zero, the ratio of these two expressions, both going to zero, is zero. So the numerator is going to zero faster, if you will, than the denominator. This says that our function f is really well approximated by this first order approximation, and that's what it means to be differentiable. So this is like saying f has a really great tangent line or a really great tangent plane approximation. But we already know our function is differentiable. I know this is zero. I'm trying to compute a directional derivative. Let me actually take this zero and slide it over to the left. We'll say zero equals this limit. And now what we're going to do is say, let's not approach a randomly. Let's approach a through the direction indicated by this unit vector u. So what I'm going to do is set x equal to a plus a little step in the direction of u. As x goes to a, that's equivalent to saying h here is going to zero. So what I'm going to do is take this quotient, and everywhere I have x, I'm going to replace it with this new expression. And then to let x go to a is to let h go to zero. So we'll say that this is going to be the limit as the scalar h goes to zero of f of a plus hu minus f of a. I'm going to distribute this negative minus the gradient of f at a dot x minus a, but x minus a is hu. Okay, this is our new numerator. And then our new denominator is going to be the distance between a plus hu minus a. That's obviously going to simplify a lot. Like so. Okay, so immediately our denominator, we have the a's cancel. And the length of h times u is just going to be the size of h. It's going to be the absolute value of h because u is unit length. I'm going to go ahead and use that knowledge on the next line. So let me make that remark over here that the vector norm of h times u is the absolute value of h times the length of u, but the length of u is one, it's a unit vector. So the whole denominator just turns into the absolute value of h, which means that I can take the numerator and denominator and put them inside of one large absolute value. So this is going to be the limit as h goes to zero of the absolute value of this quotient now, where I'm going to have this numerator divided by h. Let me go ahead and break it apart into two expressions. So we'll have f of a plus hu minus f of a all over h minus, I'll go ahead and do this. So gradient of f at a dot, the h can pop out in front. So it's going to be h times the gradient of f at a dot u. Okay, so I've just pulled that scalar in front of this dot product, and then we need to divide this by h. Okay, I did a couple of algebra steps all at the same time. So let me just say out loud what I did. This was the absolute value of something divided by the absolute value of h. So I enclosed the quotient inside of one large absolute value. And then if you read across, this is the original numerator. So it's the first two terms, I'm missing parentheses. It's f of a plus hu minus f of a minus the gradient of f at a dot hu. But since in a dot product, scalars can pull out front, I pulled that h out front so that we can now cancel that out in the second term. Okay, so it was original numerator divided by the absolute value of h. And now we're actually at the conclusion. This part, after canceling, has no more dependence on h. This is actually, if you look at it, it's the gradient of f at a dot u. Nothing here has anything to do with the limit we're taking. The gradient of f at a is a vector that exists. U is a unit length vector that exists. This is just a scalar number. Has nothing to do with anything happening as the limit of h goes to zero. And then if you look at this, as h goes to zero, this is the definition of the directional derivative of f at a in the direction of u. We started at a, we took a little step in the direction of u, and then we divided out by the size of the step, or the scalar h. So this, as h goes to zero, goes to the directional derivative of f at a in the direction of u. We don't need to prove this limit exists. We already know it exists and it equals zero because our function was differentiable. So we had that very strong hypothesis to start with. So this limit exists and goes to zero, which means that as h goes to zero, this has to go to this. So this tells us the directional derivative of f at a in the direction of u equals the gradient of f at a dot u. All right, and that concludes the proof. So this dot product formula for the directional derivative comes right out of this way of characterizing differentiability for a function at the point A.